Dearly beloved, I want to talk to you about three things today. Today I want to speak to you about what is grace, grace and law. And then the last thing I want to discuss is about the mark of the beast. And I will explain to you what he means. Do you understand how these grace teachers tell us that all we need to do is to believe in grace? We're under grace, we're not under law. So we need to do nothing. How is it that the law is no longer relevant? If a kingdom, for example, there are no laws, how are people going to understand their rights and responsibility, where they stand in that kingdom? It's the same with the Word of God. If we dispense with the Word of God, the law, then we don't know where we're going. Why do you suppose that Paul talks about we're under grace? The reason being, remember that Paul was the last apostle called to the Gentiles, and the Jewish Christians were urging the Gentile Christians to keep all the Jewish rules and laws in order for them to be saved, because they were looking to the means, the end of the law, to be their salvation. And according to Paul, no, Jesus Christ came, God gave his son as a sacrifice to pay the penalty in our places. So he is the end of the law. So are we saying that the law is done away with? No, clearly not, because Paul talks about the Bible, the law, being a schoolmaster. What does a schoolmaster? He schools us. The law teaches us to go to Christ, who is the one who saves us. So we cannot dispense with the law. If we dispense with the law, then we have nothing to show us what Christ has done. It's so ironic that in the Bible, the psalmist, David, tells us that in all the psalms he talks about, the longest psalm is 119. Each verse talks about the Word of God, which is so important. And in 189, in Psalm 119, verse 89 talks about, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. What does that mean? It means the Word of God is settled. We cannot dispense with it. And the psalmist also tells us that thy word have I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against thee. So what does that mean? Because the Word of God guides us. He also says that the Word of God is like a light to our feet, to show us where we are walking, that we do not stumble. So how can we dispense with the law of God? We cannot. It's a foolish thing to say that the law, we're no longer under the law, because law and grace go hand in hand. This is my understanding of it. Why would Paul in 2 Philippians 2, verses 12 to 13, tells the people to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling? How would you work out your own salvation if you're already under grace and you don't need to do anything? Because you need to look to the law and see your standing before God. It's like having your husband or wife, and every time, every day to day living, you wrong each other or your children, but you need to apologize. You need to say, I was wrong, forgive me. No less than God expects us to do that, because when we're wrong, we need to repent, repentance. Why would the Apostle John tell us, as in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, if we sin, we have an advocate who, if we confess our sins, he will forgive our sins. Why would John say this? If we are under grace, we do not need to do anything, but we still need to confess our sins, because every day the law is a schoolmaster. It teaches us what to do. So this is really important. You cannot dispense with the law. For example, in Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 26 to 27, the prophet tells us that God himself speaking there, that I will write my laws into your heart to make you obey me. So the law would be written in our hearts. If the law is dispensed with, why would God say the law would be written in our hearts so that we can obey him? I believe that the law of God goes back to the Garden of Eden. Don't you agree? Because Adam and Eve were given instruction. Although the law was not written down, they were aware of it. They were instructed what to do and what not to do. But they decided to disobey God. So the law was there in the beginning of time when God created man. Remember that Lucifer and his wicked demons were cast out because they rebel against the law of God, the commandments of God. This is why they came to earth. They were cast out, the war in heaven. Revelation chapter 12 tells us that there were war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the devil, but the devil's place was no longer found and he was cast into the earth. So this is the law of God. Guess who is got an antagonistic towards the law of God? It's Satan. Satan is the one who tells us that we no longer need to accept the law because all you need is Jesus has done it. How would you know how God requires of you if you do not open his word? Because his word tells you. How would you know that just being under grace and you claim that you're hearing the voice of the Holy Spirit, how would you test that the voice speaking to you is the right voice, not the apostate voice, the fallen angels trying to mislead you? So we need the law of God. We definitely do. We cannot dispense with the law of God. According to Revelation 22:14, it says that those who keep God's commandments will have the right to the tree of life. This is the last book in the Bible that tells us that commandments are important. God's commandments are important, so we cannot dispense with it. So my word to you now is that do not just believe that you need to do nothing. All you have to do is to believe in Jesus Christ. Belief and action, do they not go together? If you have belief in something, you show it by your faith. Just like Abraham, God called him to come out of his country and to show him a place. And he obeyed God. He obeyed God by his faith. He did not know where he was going. He believed God and came out without questioning. So the word of God, with our faith, we obey the Lord. Do not question it. If there's no law, again, for example, I can come to your home and dispossess you and say, these are my property. Get out and put you out. What would you do? You would do nothing. So laws are there for restraint. The law of God is to restrain us from the wicked path. We need the law of God to guide us every day. Because our salvation, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, wicked spirits in high places. So how would you know this spirit? How would you have the power unless the word of God tells you what the truth is? So my friends, I'm telling you, law and grace must go hand in hand. They're inseparable. Without the law, you do not know what God's intentions towards us is. Without the law, what is the power Jesus has bequeathed the earth? We do not know. And Jesus tells us that when the Spirit of truth shall come, in John chapter 16, he will reprove you of sin and unrighteousness. Where do we find sin and righteousness? In the law of God. So my friends, you cannot dispense with the law of God. It's inseparable because it's the one which teaches us the way to God. And then it's like a mirror. When I stand in front of the mirror, this mirror tells me what I look like. If I'm dirty, my face is dirty, the mirror tells me, and I go to clean my face. So we see our faces as it were in the Word of God. Then we go to Jesus, is the one who saves us, you see. So it's inseparable. We cannot dispense with the law of God. So the next thing I want to talk about is something they're saying call the mark of the beast. What is the mark of the beast? Dearly beloved, the mark of the beast is not a barcode that most people suppose. But in the Bible, we find this in Revelation chapter 13. It talks about a people who would be forced to have a mark on their hand and their forehead. This is talking about a false worship. If you do not have this mark, you will not be allowed to buy or sell, because you must have this mark on your hand. So this mark is not a barcode, but what it is an apostate day of worshiping God. God created the heavens and earth. And in Exodus chapter 20, verses 9 to 13, 6 days shalt thou labor, but on the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. So why, ask yourself, why is it that all Christendom, everybody is worshipping on the first day of the week? Why do they do this when the Word of God says the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God? Why do they do it? The answer is found in Rome's Challenge. I have this little book. It's written, this book is written, is saying that why do Protestants keep Sunday? And the writer of this book is by Carlyle B. Haynes. Carlyle B. Haynes. It's called From Sabbath to Sunday. Well, the Sabbath was changed in the first century in 358 AD. In 358 by Constantine, the Pope, because he became a Christian and he introduced pagan ideas into Christianity. And they've decided, for the sake of political alliance, to bring pagans into Christianity. Now pagans worshipped on the first day of the week, which is the sun god day. So they decided to force everyone to worship God. They claim that they transfer the solemnity of Saturday to Sunday, that everyone worship on this day. If you look at the Encyclopedia of the Roman Catholics, they boasted, we have power to do this, because if we did not have power to change God's laws, why would our children, i.e. Protestant world, follow us to worship on Sunday? So my friends, I'm telling you that Sunday is not the right day of worship, but Saturday. Remember, in the Old Testament, the book of Daniel, incidentally, is a book or apocalyptic book, just as the book of Revelation is. They go hand in hand. So the prophet Daniel was captured from Jerusalem to Babylon in slavery. And this king called King Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. God gave him a dream so that God showed him what is to come in the latter day, especially in our time. He dreamed on his bed that he saw a golden image, and everybody came to worship this golden image. So none of the soothsayers, the magicians, or all the peoples in his realm could tell him the dream or the interpretation except Daniel. Daniel was brought and he gave the king interpretation and the dream itself. And Daniel told him that, O king, you are that head of the gold, the image you saw, you're the head. So in hearing this, of course he praised God for a season, and then one day he lifted himself up. He had a dream of another image, and he decided to make an image to the people of all his provinces everywhere in the world. So when they hear music and dance, everybody must fall down and worship his golden image and his gods. Anyway, there were three Hebrew boys who were also Daniel's companions. They refused to worship the golden image, and they were brought to King Nebuchadnezzar, and he asked them, have you refused to worship my gods and my golden image? They said, oh king, be it known to you that even if you play your music and do anything, we will not worship your god. So he heated up a furnace of fire, fiery furnace, and they put the three of them into the fiery furnace, hoping that they'll be burned. But guess what? The Lord Jesus came in the fire with them. Not even their clothes were singed, nothing, their hair, nothing happened to them. But the Lord Jesus was there in the fire amongst them. And when the king, his conscience troubled him, he woke up and went to the place to find out what happened. And he called out, Meshach, Abednego, worshippers of the true God. And they answered, O king, nothing has happened to us because the Lord sent his angel to not give us any hurt. So we are pure before the Lord. We have done nothing wrong. So they came out of the fiery furnace and he promoted them. He promoted them to eminence. And meanwhile, the people who took the three Hebrew boys into the furnace were killed because the commandments of the king were so severe that they were killed instantly. So what we're seeing there is that when Nebuchadnezzar made a golden image, he made it all gold instead of just the head of gold which he represented for people to worship him. Those who refused to worship were killed instantly. So what I'm saying is that the book of Daniel and Revelation are together, because in the book of Revelation, it says that this image, this beast, they were called a beast, and the dragon and the beast. So what is the dragon? The dragon represents the devil, according to Revelation 12. And the beast is a system, political system in this world, according to the last verses in Revelation 13, is the name of a man, and the name, the number of the name is 666, 666. Who is this 666? This political person or system call themselves the vicar of Christ, the whole world, that the whole world worships. So this is the system going to take over the world again, and they want people to worship them. And if you do not have the mark of the beast, i.e. the false apostate day that people worship, Sunday is not God's day, because the Sabbath is solemnized by God to set aside for man to worship him. If you look at Luke chapter 2, there's a controversy between the Pharisees and Jesus. They're saying that why do you and your disciple do not obey the Jewish rules and traditions? And he's telling them that, know that the Sabbath was made for man. The Sabbath preeminated man. So God set aside the Sabbath for us to worship him. So I'm telling you that in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve worship God from the beginning. Why is it that Satan is so angry against the day of God. God has made for us to worship him. Because the Sabbath is a symbol of God's rulership. It's a symbol of God's rulership. And it's the only, out of the Ten Commandments, it's the fourth commandment is the Sabbath. The fourth commandment is the Sabbath. So we know that the devil is angry, and Sunday is the devil's day. The people worship him. So if in ignorance you are worshiping God on a Sunday, because Sunday is not his day. Saturday is his day, because this day is very holy. Do you understand that when people who are merchants, when they open their doors on a Saturday, they make more money on that day than any other day, because the day is blessed by the Lord, by God. This day is so important. So what I'm telling you is that find a Sabbath-keeping church and worship God according to the details of your heart. Because if you love the Lord, you want to keep his commandments, then find people who keep his commandments. Of course, that we have the Jews with us. They keep Saturday. Not just the Jews, but there are a group of peoples called the Seventh-day Adventists. They've been keeping the Sabbath since 150 years ago. And there are other Christians today who have found that Saturday is the Sabbath, and they are worshiping God on this day. So it's not the Jewish Sabbath, it's for the whole world. As I told you in the beginning, that the Sabbath was introduced, was made for man at the beginning in the Garden of Eden. We see that in Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 20, God talks about the Sabbath being a seal between himself and us, a seal. So there's a seal, the Sabbath is a seal. Yeah, so there we have it. And also regarding Isaiah 66, 22 to 23, God is talking about creating a new heaven and a new earth. In the new earth, the prophet is telling us that the people will come to worship God. They will come to worship God on the Sabbath. So you see, even in the new earth, the Sabbath is important. Not Sunday, but the Sabbath. Do you know the reason why all this confusion going back to AD 358? Because people like to follow tradition. It's easier for human beings to follow tradition than think for themselves. Many evangelists know that Sunday is not the Sabbath, but they refuse to think, even consider it. They do not consider it because it's too much. It will make it means that you have to change your ways. Nobody likes to change their ways. They don't. They don't like to do the unknown. It's alien to human nature. But God is calling his people in Revelation chapter 18. He said, "Come out of her, my people, and be ye separate. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will accept you, receive you to my sons and daughters. Come out of her, my people." So the Lord is calling us out one by one. As I mentioned to you earlier already, the law is not done away with. The reason why we have so many discrepancies in the world, thoughts and ideas, is because the devil is a liar from the beginning. He wants to confuse everybody's mind. But don't be confused. The truth as it is in Christ is found in this book. You will not be confounded. He will lead you to the truth, because Jesus promised that when the Spirit of truth comes, he will lead you to the truth. So let the Holy Spirit lead you to the truth. You will never be ashamed. Well, I told you that the psalmist says that thy word is a lamp. That's what it is. And he said, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled, this book is settled in heaven. There's nothing the devil or anyone can do to discredit the Bible, the word of God, because he's been through so many histories, thousands of years of history. So we know the word is true and constant. So I'm urging you, dearly beloved, check out all these things first of all. Like Paul says, Paul did in Acts chapter 17, verse 22, he went to a place called Berea, and all the people from Berea went to check out the Torah to find out what Paul was telling them was the truth. So I'm telling you, check out everything I've told you to find out the truth, and God will lead you to the truth, because you owe it to yourself. Because one day, when we face the judgment, you cannot blame anyone, only yourself. The call is gone out to the world. Thy word has gone out to the world as a witness to everyone, a witness to everyone. So stand up if you love the Lord, stand up and accept his word. My Muslim friends, you've heard this idea that the Bible is tarif. It's not. Do not accept the word of other people. It's not. But judge it for yourself. Study it and see whether this is true. How can you condemn something without judging it first? Just don't accept other people's word. Study for yourself and find the truth. As the psalmist said, thy word is forever settled in heaven. So this word can never be erased by human beings, no matter how much they malign it. But I'm asking you, in the name of Jesus, in the name of God, take this book and study it. You'll be enlightened. So this is my word to you today. Find a Sabbath-keeping church and keep the Sabbath as God wants you to. Because a time is coming when the world, the history of the world is going to be turned upside down. All the authorities there are going to say, we need to go back to basics. I'm sure you've heard that before, because we have all the calamities coming upon the world. Satan is going to unleash calamities upon the world, and the people are going, the heads of states of many countries are going to be together to say, it's because God is angry with us, we need to do something. So they will force people to worship God against the dictates of their hearts, just like Nebuchadnezzar did. The book of Revelation is telling us. So, study the word of God. When the time comes, you know where you stand. Stand firm on the word of God. Let nothing shift you. Let no wind or doctrine shift you, but believe in the word of God. I thank you, my brothers and sisters, for hearing me again today. But before I go, as always, let me pray for you. Our eternal Father, Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to come before your people to speak to them, in the name of Jesus, who had died to save us all. So, Lord, I ask that you lead your people, your children all over the world, to your truth, as it is in Christ Jesus. Lead them to the truth. Convict them of truth so that they can change from the wicked ways and turn their hearts to you so that you can save them. Because you said in your word that you're not willing for any to perish, but all to come to your light and be saved. So Father, I'm asking you, let your eye be singly upon these people to guide, direct them and save them, Father. Thank you for choosing me to speak to your people today. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.